time with everybody, we're gonna get started. We'll see if anybody else comes in, and this happens really bad, so just be patient. So just a little introduction. My name is Katelyn, Wysong. I introduced myself all the time today, but thank you for listening. I'm the Southeast District Vice President of Membership for Tallahassee State. I'm a life member of the Theta Phi Chapter at the University of Central Florida. A little bit about me, when I was an active sister, I was Vice President of Special Projects, and then Chapter President, and then District PM, so I'm really excited to present this workshop today. It's something that I'm really passionate about, so it's a really cool opportunity to be able to meet with you guys and share some knowledge and some of my passions with such a great group of leaders, so I'm really glad that you're here today. So this workshop is titled, Bloom Where You're Planted. I'm not a public speaker, so if I start to ramble, be patient with me, or tell me if I talk too fast, I promise I will bite on the next two. Okay. Cool. So this workshop was inspired by a lot of quotes that I found really inspirational and moving about personal growth and change and growth within the sisterhood and the brotherhood. So I have a lot of quotes in here that I think are really awesome. So if you take anything from this presentation today, keep one of these little dudes in your mind. So the first one is, don't go through life, grow through life, which I try and remember in all of my endeavors. I think it's a really important thing to live by. Going through life is one thing, but growing, constantly changing, improving upon yourself, and helping other people improve upon themselves is something that I think is really important, and I think we've all taken a first step in doing that by joining the sorority or fraternity and coming to GLC and participating in things like this. So keep that in mind. So the things that I want to cover in this workshop, I have three main topics. So the first one is personal development. So before you can help others grow, you have to make sure that you're growing, that you are enabling yourself to be successful and be a good leader. And to always remember the things that you need to keep in mind in order to help other people be successful. So I'm going to focus on developing yourself a little bit. College is a huge time of growth, and you're figuring out who you are, who you want to be. You know, you might start with one major and then completely change it halfway through, which I know quite a few people have done, and it's weird to have to find your passions while you're in school and trying to study things and whatnot. So I think personal development is something that everybody should focus on while they're in college. The next is growing within your organization. So we have really fabulous chapters that do a really great job of educating their membership candidates to become active sisters. But once they become sisters, we kind of, sisters or brothers, I apologize. Once they become active within their chapter, we kind of fall off sometimes, and we don't continue to educate them to continue to help them grow and enable them to be successful within your chapter. So it's one thing that I have really tried to focus on during my term. We started a CMVP committee, CMVP, the Continuing Membership Education Plan. It makes me really, really happy that we were able to do this this year and to share this. So I talk about that a little bit in this workshop, so I'll go into more detail about it later. And then the last is helping others bloom. So now that you've developed yourself and you know who you want to be and what your goals are, and then you've grown within your chapter, you're now an officer, and you have, you know, younger people in your organization who you want to help them be successful and reach their goals. You know, so I'm just going to talk about some ways that you can make sure that people are accomplishing what they want to accomplish. And it's always a really great feeling when you watch somebody grow and do something really great and know that you were a part of helping them do that. So another quote, strength and growth come only through continuous effort and struggle. So no matter what you do in life, you're going to struggle. Everybody knows this. I'm pretty sure it's something that you've all heard in your life. You're always going to continue to grow, whether you want to or not. I always try to tell people, make sure you embrace this growth. You know, change is scary, like I said, but growing is just so beneficial to you. So that's what I want you guys to take away from this workshop. Okay, so the first topic is personal development. So you've already taken the first step in developing yourselves as people. You've given yourselves roots within your college. So you apply to a college, that's a home that you found. So to me, finding yourself and developing yourself starts with finding homes and places where you feel comfortable. So you've taken the first step, you you apply to a college, you have a whole community of people who you can reach out to, who are going to be there for you, who root for the same teams as you, who want the same things. Then you picked a major, and now you have this whole group of people who are studying the same things, they have the same passions as you. So that's another home that you have. And then you join a band, obviously. So, you know, the bands, you develop these bonds with people and these relationships with people in bands because we all share the same passion for the same thing. And then you guys have taken it a step further and joined a service organization, a sorority and a fraternity that are meant to serve the bands and do things for other people. And you put yourself in a position where you can be very selfless and give back to these other people. So you've taken the first step in developing yourself and giving yourself roots. And then you need to establish goals. And I know this is something that everybody talks about, we say it's really important, but I really think that establishing short-term and long-term goals is really important, especially in having the same amount of cap time. So you never really know what your goals are going to be when you start and how they're going to change. For example, when I first joined Kappa Sigma, I was an active. I never thought that I'd be an officer, never thought that I'd be a president. I never in the world thought that I would run for district office and present something like this to my peers. That always sounded so intimidating to me, and I just didn't think it was attainable, so I just didn't have to try. And then finally found a little confidence. I fell in love with TBS and with this bond and these people that I was surrounding myself with. But I said, you know what, I'm going to do something to give back. And so I did something really scary for myself, and I ran for an office position. And to my surprise, I was elected, and I really didn't think that I would. Like, I was running out of posts, and I was like, no, somebody's still going to come up out of nowhere, and it's not going to be me, and it's going to be a disaster, and I'm going to burst into tears. But that didn't happen. So I had the chance to give back to this story that meant so much to me and did so much to me, and so that became one of my goals. And then once I had an office position, my goals started to change. That's when I realized that you can do so much more for this organization than you realize when you're a membership candidate, when you're still learning what it means to be a sister or a brother, or you know what it means to surround yourself with these people. You don't know where you can go and how much you can grow. So that's when I started to develop these long-term goals. So always trying to remember when you're going through college, set small goals for yourself that are attainable, that you can reach and feel good about yourself. Make sure you're empowering yourself so that you feel good, you know that you're growing, you know that you're making improvements. So short-term and long-term goals are so important. The next thing is build on your soft skills. So soft skills are things that you can take into your life and your professional activities, whatever career you're going to join, if you're going to do any outside things, and if you're going to give back to your community, whatever. These skills are going to help enable you to do the things that you're passionate about. So communication is one of the big ones. Communication, I'm sure, is something that your chapters have talked about a lot, or maybe if they haven't, it's something that you should be talking about. Communicating with other people, especially your peers, when you're in a leadership role, can be really weird. You have to deliver bad news. Let's say a membership candidate says they want to terminate their candidacy, and then you're the BPM at the time. What are you going to do? How are you going to tell the chapter that this person no longer wants to be a part of your organization? And if you're like me, it can be really heartbreaking to have to go through that. So communicating that to other people can be really difficult. So make sure that it's something that you're talking about with your chapters, that you're figuring out what are your processes when things like this happen. And then as you start to develop these processes within your chapter, you learn for yourself how you communicate with other people. Like, some people are really good at just going up to somebody and saying, hey, I think you can improve upon this. I think you're doing really great, blah, 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 and that's their leadership strategy. Other people lead by example. They don't want to go and have to tell somebody something that can be kind of awkward. They want to just do it and hope that people follow, and usually they do. So learning how to communicate with your peers, with your sisters, with your membership candidates is something that's so important, and then you can use these things in your professional life. So I work full-time now since I graduated last May. I'm an event planner, so I communicate with people all the time. And I used to suck at communicating with people. I was so bad. I hated running meetings. I didn't like running committees. I was like, this is terrible. I don't like talking to people. And I sat there and I was like, why did I choose this career where this is literally what I do for a living? That's so weird that I did this. But it was my goal, and that's what I wanted to do. So Tom and Sigma gave me the skills to go into the workplace and feel comfortable running a meeting and talking to people and telling them my ideas because I was able to do that with my chapter. So developing your communication can be super important. Sorry about that. Okay, next thing is problem solving. So, you know, there's going to be problems with your chapter, there's going to be conflict, nobody's perfect. When problems arise, how are you going to solve them? You just kind of learn how you're problem solving as things happen. So ZSI has this really funny, like, I don't even know what to call it. We have these raincoats for the band, and we hate them because they just always cause so many problems. And when I was DPS, there was this one day where it starts pouring down rain as we're marching to the stadium. Our raincoats were on the truck that was on the way to the stadium, so we were all just like scrambling, like, what's going on? And everybody's coming at me and saying, what are the raincoats doing? You're the one that's responsible for figuring out this problem. So I kind of just had to learn how I was going to solve these problems. And eventually we found a solution and it ended up being fine. But when you're thrust into a leadership role and you don't know what problems are going to come at you, it's really important for you to think about how you're going to handle them when they do arise. So I always try to tell people that, you know, come to me and ask for advice, make sure you're thinking about these things and what are you going to do in the worst case scenario? What are you going to do in the best case scenario? You know, like, what was I going to do if nobody showed up to this workshop? That'd be really sad. But I might as well do it anyway, just to the camera. And you're like, you should watch it later, you know? Or if the room was so full that nobody could fit, then, you know, we have solutions for that. So problem solving is something that you should try and take back your chapters and make sure that you're coming up with plans for all the situations that could happen. The next thing is collaboration. So obviously you're in a sorority or fraternity, we're going to collaborate with people, you have committees and whatnot, and you're doing things together. So collaboration is something that you need to figure out how you are going to collaborate with other people. What leadership role are you going to take on where you have to collaborate with these people, and how are you going to accomplish this? So, you know, are you going to come in and be very strict and be the type of leader that says, this is how it is, this is how I like it, delegate it out to other people, or are you going to join that and say, let's do this together and show them how to do it? So think about how you're going to collaborate with people and trying to develop yourself as a leader. So keep challenging yourself. I kind of talked about this a little bit, talking about my background and how I challenged myself to run this position that was so terrifying for me. Don't forget that challenging yourself, even if you end up failing, is still going to teach you something in the end. And you know, it's a really hard thing to do to say, I might do this and I might fall on my face, but if you fall on your face, you know, okay, maybe I should change this. And then you learn how you can improve upon the things that you're doing. And then establish your morals and ethics, which you kind of already have a code of ethics, a code of, you know, morals that you want to follow. In Tade Sigma, in Kappa Kappa Psi, our purposes and our HFIs, guaranteed yes, they kind of give you these examples of how you should be acting morally and how you want to develop yourself. What morals do you want to have as a person? So even if you take yourself out of a setting where you're in a sorority, what type of person do you want to be? What morals do you want to take from TBS and Kappa Kappa Psi that you can take onto the rest of your life? So the next part is growing your organization. And this is the bulk of this workshop because I think it's so important to keep thinking about these things. So from membership candidate to active sister or brother, like I said, you're going through this process. Most of you have really awesome processes. You're continuing to develop them and to change them and grow. And we've gotten really good at changing things when we need to when it comes to our membership candidates. But then, what happens when they become sisters? How do you know what they don't know? You think, you know, you taught them everything that you think they need to know, but what kind of things did you wish you knew more about when you became an active sister? Does anyone have anything that they'd like to share that they wish they knew more about when they became active? Is that a woman? Yeah. So he was saying how to be more confident, how to be more positive, and being confident in yourself. So, you know, that's a question that you should be asking to your membership candidates. Do you feel confident in what you know? Do you feel positive about what you're doing in the organization that you're in? And I know it can be kind of scary to have to ask people, how am I doing? What do you think? Because, you know, you don't want to get any bad answers, but it's important to see how you can improve and how you can be changing things. So, what else? So, after your sisters, after your membership candidates become sisters, ask them those questions. Have a meeting with them after their sisters, maybe after they've gone through their first chapter with you as an active, and see what do they need to learn more about, what do I need to teach them about, and then you have the tools that you can use to help them improve. Okay, so ways that you can help them grow. A lot of times I hear that sisters and brothers struggle in chapter meetings because Robert's Rules is really confusing when you're first in an organization. You're like, what is this thing? Why are people putting a handout like that? What is this secondary thing? What's the friendly amendment? I have no idea what's going on. It can be really scary. So hold a mock chapter meeting while they're a membership candidate or even after they're an active sister or brother, and it will help them get acclimated. And make sure you're telling your bigs to educate their littles about this so that it's something that they can learn and they can feel comfortable being in your organization. Reach out to your district council to help them teach about district events. I know this like seems kind of obvious to me, but it's something that I think we should do a lot more. Like, you have these people that are experts in the events that they're planning, like DLC, for example. Let's say you had no idea what DLC was, or your newly initiated sisters or brothers had no idea what it was either. Instead of you having to try and explain, oh, it's this kind of like leadership conference that just kind of like happens in like February, maybe? Why not come to your district officers and say, hey, do you want to meet them? Do you want to talk to them? That gives them another resource and another person to reach out to. And this person is going to be an expert in the field, of, you know, because we've spent months planning DLC at this point. So why not reach out to them and use your resources? Build a CMVP and tailor it to them. So that's the CMVP that I promised to talk about because I love CMVPs. So for those of you that just joined, a CMVP is a continuing membership education plan. So it's something that you put together similar to an MVP for your membership candidates where instead of educating these people about your organization, you're now educating these people who are already sisters and brothers about or about the organization or about how to go through life, how to apply the things that they've learned in their process into the rest of their lives. So building a CMVP to me is super important. Okay, there it is again, CMVP. Can you tell that I love them? So build a successful CMVP program. And this can take a little trial and error. Sometimes when you first start, you have no idea what the chapter wants to know about. You don't know whether these events are going to be successful. It's going to be difficult trying to establish this for the first time, but it's something that you should try at least. So, you know, trial and error. If you fail, you fail. You learn from it. I'd like some of you to take on that role of educating people, of being in charge of the CMVP and continuing membership education. Don't just throw it on your VPM, unless that's who you want to take it on. That's fine too. But the VPM is focused on educating these membership candidates. So to me, I think it's a good idea to have a separate officer in charge of that. And if you want to put it on an existing officer, that's fine. If you want to create a CMEO, like some chapters have, that's great too. But pick somebody who's in charge of that that's going to put their full focus into continuing to educate your sisters and brothers. And then add it to your constitution. If this is something that your chapter is really passionate about, make sure that it's going to happen continuing. Make sure it's going to happen for the rest of the longevity of your chapter. And, you know, this will enable you to change it as you see fit to, you know, just make sure that it's going on, that it's working well, and gives you the opportunity to do that for everybody. And then give them guidelines and policies. I think that this is something that a lot of chapters that already have a CMVP can start to implement. Some of the chapters are already doing it, which is really, really great. But, you know, don't just give them this role and say, you have to educate everybody that's active now. Here you go, online. That can be kind of intimidating. So, you know, tell them what you want when you're creating this position. If you add it to your constitution, say, we want to have X many events a semester, and we want to make sure that there's always a hazing workshop, that there's always a resume building workshop, something of the sort, that there's always a mock chapter, or whatever guidelines your chapter feels you need, make sure that you're including those in your constitution. Okay. So in your CMVP, you're developing active sisters, so don't just teach them how to be active within your chapter, teach them how to be successful in life. So you can do things like resume building workshops, interpersonal communication workshops, goal setting, which can be really important. And goal setting doesn't have to mean just for yourself. Goal setting can mean for your entire chapter. What do you as a chapter want to accomplish? Let's say you have this meeting and somebody says, I want to host DLC or I want to host SED. And at first you're like, you're crazy. That's ridiculous. That's so mature. But then you sit down and you're like, wait, this is a really good opportunity for me to help my district, for me to help my organization as a whole. And you know, if you sit down and have those conversations, then you're already making progress with your chapter. You can have workshops on healthy lifestyle, which doesn't necessarily relate to TBS or KSI, but it's a good skill to have. It's a good thing to teach about. And if that's something that your chapter feels passionate about, then why not? Campus resources, that can be really awesome. So, you know, like I said in the beginning, you've picked a home, you've picked a school that you feel you resonate with, and now you're more involved in it. You're in organizations, you're in bands, you're doing things, you're in your later classes. And sometimes we forget to think about the resources that our schools are giving us. So have a workshop about what resources are available to you, and that can be really helpful to not just you, but everybody in your chapter. Okay, so talk a lot about standing peace, and we'll move on. So going from an active sister to an officer, sister or brother, I'm sorry. Okay. Becoming an officer can be a really intimidating thing, like I said multiple times. But I think that there are a lot of tools that chapters should start implementing to help these people feel comfortable running for these positions. You want to enable them so that they do feel positive, like our friend over here said, that they feel confident and good enough to be able to run for this position and feel like they can get it, or if they don't, feel like at least they gave it a shot and they did their best. So the things that you can start implementing are officer shadowing. Let's say that somebody comes up to you and says, I want to be a VPN one day. And they're like, what the heck does a VPN do? Because you don't really know what you're doing until you get into it. When you see it from the outside, you can kind of put together what you think is going to happen. And then when you're actually in that role, it can be completely different. So if somebody tells you that, offer them to shadow you for a day. Come into one of your education meetings and help you run the meeting if you want to. There's no harm in getting other people involved in your education process. So Zeta Psi does this thing where we have a few assistant roles, which I think is really cool, and I think I would love to see other chapters doing it. I'm sure other chapters do have it, because I'm from Zeta Psi, so obviously I know that example. So two of those positions are AME and SPA. So AME is Assistant Membership Educator. So this person is usually somebody that wants to be a VPN, so they set their goal of being a VPN at some point, or maybe further than that. Maybe they just really love membership education and they just want to help. But this person is there so that A, they're learning what it takes to be a VPN. B, they're participating and they're teaching your membership candidates how to grow, how to become sisters and brothers. And there was one more thing that I forgot, so we're moving on. SPA is Special Projects Assistant. So this one helps the VPSP with all the service. So the SPA, when I was a VPSP, I decided to give them roles of their own. So I wanted them to not only shadow me and see what I'm doing as a VPSP, but also have some responsibility so that they, you know, feel like they're doing things important, they're making a difference. So give them roles like concert receptions. They're going to be in charge of that. And this way, they have a small leadership role. They're feeling good about themselves. They're feeling enabled. They're helping your organization. And you're not feeling overwhelmed, because being an officer can be overwhelming. There's a lot of things that you need to get done. There's a lot of ideas that you have. So you have things you have to do. You have things that you want to do. You have things that maybe you dream about doing, but just aren't attainable yet. So you have all these things that you want to do, and there's so many ways that you can delegate these so that other people can also help you and make you feel good about what you're doing. So that was kind of also delegate small roles. Okay, so your existing officers. So I went from VPSD to president. So I was one type of officer, and then I changed to a different type of officer. And it was weird because once you become an officer, you kind of feel awkward asking, oh, I want to shadow you, because now you're on the same level as these other officers. And it can just be a very awkward topic. So, you know, you want to make sure that you are enabling yourself to be successful in the next role that you want to take on. So set goals for this next role that you want. You know, sometimes you think that you want to run one role and then you create a platform for that and you realize, no, I want to do something else. And I'll be very honest, that's what happened with me in the district office. I originally was like, I want to be VPSC. That sounds really awesome. Because I held that role. It was something that I was comfortable with. It was something that I was passionate about. So I said, okay, why not? So I created a platform for it. And then somebody came up to me and said, hey, Katelyn, I think you'd actually be a really good VPM. And I was like, shook, because to me, I had never done any human membership education other than to help my current VPM, you know, develop our MVP and continue to grow on that. But I was like, well, no, you're crazy, not doing that. And then I put more thought into it and I said, you know what, let me give it a shot. So I created a platform for VPN, and I ended up falling in love with it. I was like, there's so many things that I want to do, there's so many things that I have a chance to do that I think I can do really well, and I ended up running for VPN instead, and here I am. So don't ever forget that even though you think one thing, it can change to another very quickly, and it's important to consider all your options, because you never know where you're going to be good at until you try. So. I got a little off topic there, but we're going to go back now. So, progress evaluations. Evaluations can get kind of tricky because you want people to be able to be honest with you, but you also don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. And I know that's a really hard goal to attain. So, what I've seen some chapters do is have anonymous progress evaluations. So, halfway through your term, whether you go back in the spring or the fall, send out a survey where you ask, you know, what has this position done well? What has this officer accomplished? What do you think they can improve upon? What would you like to see out of this officer? So it gives them the chance to not only tell them what they're doing well and what they can improve upon, but it makes them feel good and like they're accomplishing things, and it makes your goals have an outline to say. Project surveys. So I haven't really seen a lot of people doing these, but I think it would be really awesome to implement. So let's say that you decide to participate in a new district program or a new national program. Let's say CODA. That's new for Tabata Sigma this year. It's similar to Crescendo, and it's kind of weird trying to get used to these new projects that you have to implement. You have these process for how you're doing all your focus on five things and what things you're doing. So you try CODA, and it's a huge success, but you just want to make sure that you're continuing to grow on it, you're continuing to improve upon it. So have a survey about it and say, how do you think it went? Because you planning it and say, yeah, it was great, it was flawless. But then there's people who are participating and say, I think maybe this could have been better. I think maybe that could have been better. When you're looking through it with your own eyes, you're not going to catch the small mistakes sometimes. Or maybe you do catch the small mistakes and you focus too much on them. You know, maybe you had a low turnout. And you're like, oh, I didn't motivate everybody enough, and you start to beat yourself up about it. But then you put out this survey and you ask, why didn't people participate? And it wasn't you at all. You motivated them and they wanted to be there, but maybe it was a scheduling problem. So just make sure that you're evaluating how you're doing and don't start to beat yourself up first before you find out what the actual problem was. Officer handbooks. So officer handbooks, I think, are a huge tool and enabling your officers to be successful and to continue to be successful throughout your chapter. So if you don't already have this, have your officers make a handbook of everything they've done. So for example, I'm doing this for district VPN because it's not something that we have. And I don't know why we haven't done it in the past, but I think it's something that's important. So by the end of my term, I'll be able to hand over a binder to whomever takes over after me and say, here's what I did for DLC. Here's what worked. Here's what didn't. Here's what I think maybe could work next time. Here's what I did for the CMEP committee. Here's what worked. Here's what didn't. Blah, blah, blah. And so on and so forth. And then they're going to take over this book of complete knowledge for them. And all they can do from there is improve. They can grow. And then you're helping them to grow in this position and be successful. And e-board exit meetings. So when you're on executive board, things run a little bit differently than you expect them to when you're on the outside of e-board. So now that you've elected new officers, they know what they're supposed to do as per their constitution or just whatever your chapter usually does as per tradition. But they don't know how your executive board is going to operate, per se. So why not have a meeting with your exiting e-board and your new e-board and say, here's what we did, here's how we're going to communicate. So it's important to have those conversations and make sure that you're figuring out, do we want to have a group meeting? Do we want to have phone calls? Do we want to have a weekly meeting? Are we okay with a bi-weekly meeting? What are we going to do if somebody has a problem? How are we going to solve these things? You know, make sure you talk about voting. What is the voting percentage in your on-e board? Who gets a vote and who doesn't get a vote based on who's on your executive board? So make sure you're having those meetings so that you can set your e-board up for success. And then that'll trickle down the line. If your e-board is successful, they can help your officers be successful. You can help your activists and your sisters and brothers and your membership candidates be successful. And so it just goes down the line. Okay, another quote. Help others achieve their dreams and you will achieve yours. So this is leading into the helping others bloom. Another quote for you, I really love quotes. Research has shown that helping others can make us happier at work. In fact, Dr. James Fowler has found that individual happiness benefits others up to 3 degrees of separation in social networks. So by helping others to be happy, you're not only increasing your own happiness, but also affecting an entire community as well. All right, so now that you have bloomed yourself, you have enabled yourself to be successful in all your endeavors, you want to be able to give back and help others be successful and make sure that you're doing that. Your chapter is being successful, but are your individuals reaching their goals? So you want to make sure that you're being available. Are you giving off the right aura that people feel comfortable talking to you and confiding in you when they have problems, when they have things they want to talk through? So make sure you're making yourself available to everyone. Are you being warm? Are you being receptive and listening to the root of the problem? When somebody comes to you panicking because they didn't have time to take their active sister test and blah, 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 and they go on this huge rampage, what is the actual root of the problem? Are they stressed because of the project that they have due at the same time? Do they need to reschedule? Are they uncomfortable they don't remember the knowledge? Do you need to have education classes to re-educate them about those things? So, are you being receptive? Are you listening to what the problem is? Are you trying to get to the root of the problem? Know when to let someone else take the lead. So I kind of talked about this a little bit in the section before with delegating small leadership roles. So you as an officer need to know when it's your time to let someone else shine. So let's say you're DPSP again. And somebody comes up to you and says, I have this really great idea for a service project. I think it'd be really awesome. They're super excited about it. And you're like, okay, sure, let's go for it. And they start to develop ideas. They have plans. They're doing things. They're going places. They're passionate about it. Why not let them then take that role and say, okay, I recognize you have this idea that you're passionate about, you're excited about, so I'm going to let you run with it. I'll be here if you need me. If you want some guidance on how to operate that, on how to, you know, make people do what you need them to do and delegate these roles in the service project, then it's going to make them feel good about themselves. It's going to give them an opportunity to also be a leader, and it's going to let them grow as people. Become the kind of leader that people will follow voluntarily, even if you have no title or position. So I've talked about being an officer a lot in this workshop. But I also want to recognize that you can be a leader even if you're not an officer in your chapter. If you're an active and you want to lead people, let's say you're that person that had that idea about the service project, speak up, say something, and do something about it. Because you can make a difference in your chapter even if you don't have a title of president or VPSP or what so have you. So, you know, make sure you're putting all your efforts in when you're at service projects or you're at membership events or whatnot. Be a leader. Do what you think is right and people will follow you. Be the example, like Ms. Champion was saying earlier. Be the example for everyone to follow. Okay. So when you're trying to help other people grow, you need to make sure that you're giving them the right tools. So you saying, I'm going to let you run with this service project is really great. It's a good opportunity for them. But then if you just drop them off and say, nope, here you go, and leave them be, they're not going to be successful in the end because you're not giving them the tools that they need to be successful. So, you know, some things that you could, some tools, like tangible tools that can help people. Print out your constitutions of people at the beginning of the semester if you're parliamentarian, or your bylaws if people are confused. Let's say your membership candidates, once they become sisters or brothers, say, I don't really understand the policies that we have set in place. Print those out for them, let them look through them, and give them the tools that they are gonna then take the initiative and go through. To me, it's a lot easier to hand someone a constitution and say, hey, you should look at this. This is a really great tool for you. It's a lot easier to get them to do that than to just say, you should go look at the constitution on the website. Because once they leave that room, they're not gonna think about it anymore. They're gonna say, oh, okay, I'll look at it. And then they're gonna get distracted. They're gonna go on Facebook. They're gonna do homework. They're gonna even go out and do whatever they wanna do. And they're gonna completely forget about thinking about your constitution until they come in and sit in your next meeting. And then you're like, how was that constitution research? And they haven't done anything. So make sure you're giving them these things. You know, if you're doing AACNEP, let's say you're first developing it, print it out for people, let people look through it and make sure that they understand what's happening, what you're doing, and once it's a tangible thing for them to look at, it's going to help them to make decisions on how they feel about the projects that you're doing, how they feel about the workshops that you're having. Power isn't control at all. Power is strength, and giving that strength to others. A leader isn't someone who forces others to make him stronger. A leader is someone willing to give his strength to others that they may have the strength to stand on their own. Just another quote I really love. Okay. So, understanding everyone's personal needs. When you're a leader, whether you're an officer or you're just a leader in your chapter, it's really important to think about the fact that everyone is struggling outside of TBS and KKSI, and not everything is going to be so surface level. Sometimes people are fighting battles that you know nothing about, and they're keeping it to themselves because that's how they want to handle it. So just remember to keep that in mind when you're trying to make people do things that you need them to do. Make sure that you're being perceptive to what's going on in their personal lives. And I know we would all love to separate our personal lives from our business lives if you're, you know, trying to make your organization successful and you're looking at it as an organization instead of social sorority or anything like that, make sure you're paying attention to what's going on. What's the real reason for their struggle? If they're not showing up at the chapter meetings, maybe it's not that they don't care, maybe they have something going on in their home life. And you as a leader need to be responsible enough to know that, hey, I'm gonna reach out to this person and see how they're doing. And just make sure they're okay. And maybe they don't open up to you, but at least you know that now maybe they'll feel comfortable coming to you and talking to you, and then at that point you can give them the tools for them to be successful and for them to grow. Are they not growing because they're intimidated? Do they need more guidance? Are they scared to run for this officer position? Do they not want to speak up about their service project because they think maybe people will think it's dumb? Just, you know, make sure that you're being an open chapter, that you're letting people have ideas and tell you things and experience new things within your chapter. Okay, so I've talked a lot about growing people as individuals, as officers, but you also should try and grow your chapter as a whole. We can kind of get stuck in a rut and say, this is tradition, and I love and I hate the word tradition because it's something that can be so wonderful. You can sit back and say, this is a tradition that's happened since we were founded in 1982. Data science happens. You know, so it's something that you as your chapter holds dear. But then when you apply the word tradition to something like a policy that your chapter has, oh, this is just how it's always done, blah, blah, blah. That doesn't enable you to grow your chapter. And I know we want to do what's comfortable, we want to do what we've always done, but that just can't happen. Things are going to change, life is going to change, society is going to keep moving. And unless you move along with them, you're just gonna get stuck behind and you're not gonna be successful as a chapter. So participate in national programs. There are new programs coming out all the time. Give it a try. Fail at it the first time, then improve upon it. Grow your chapter as a whole, and then maybe you can make these things a tradition. Let's say you wanna have a conduct us band, which was something that RJ did this semester, which was so cute. Maybe you did it and it was super successful. Like one of our chapters ended up on their university page for doing this conduct us ban, and it got so much PR, it was so good for them, and it made everybody feel so proud. We as a council have talked about it, and we're like, this is so wonderful, and this is what we want to see from other chapters. We want you to see you being feeling important and like you matter within your university. So, you know, make sure that you're giving these a try. Participate in district programs like the Conduct Us Band. Evaluate your progress and projects as a group. So you can have individual surveys, like I mentioned before, about how did you do in a service project in the eyes of just an individual. But then have those conversations as a chapter in your meeting where you're saying, you know, what can we do better? What do we want to do as a whole? How do we want to change this? And take into account everybody's ideas and everyone's thoughts. So this is my last quote for this workshop. Change is inevitable, growth is optional. So change is going to happen, like I said before. There's no way to avoid it. It's always going to be a thing. Growing is optional. Growing is what is in the hands of your actives, of your candidates, of your alumni. If you want to grow as a chapter, if you want to grow as individuals, you have to put in effort to make those things happen. So no matter what you do, just remember, you have to put in effort in order to grow. And growth in the end is going to be really, really good for you. Yay. Thank you for listening to me ramble on for 15 minutes. We have about 10 minutes, so does anybody have any questions that they want to ask about the workshop? Anything? Yes.
How would you recommend that the SED third party
they participate in your chapter programs? Go ahead.
Okay, I was wondering how you would recommend that we can get our members more involved in our projects and just more excited and participating more.
I would start with trying to evaluate why you think your members aren't participating. I know that's not necessarily a conventional answer, but I think it can help you start to take the first steps in figuring out what then you can do in order to make sure that they are participating. Maybe it's that they don't like the programs that you're giving them, or maybe it's that they want to see it a different way. So talk to them, get them involved. I would say try and get as many people involved in the planning process of your projects as possible. Not necessarily give everybody a role in it, but make sure you're hearing everyone's opinions and make sure that a lot of people have hands in it. Once you put your time and effort into something, you're more likely to make sure it's successful because you've put time that you could have spent doing something else into this project. So I think, yeah, that's kind of my reason. Yes.
I was just going to ask if you could go back to the slide that was referring to helping others home with when it says pay attention to your concerns. It starts with, it says, well, the first thing is to pay attention to the details.
Okay, that's my whole presentation. So I guess we're gonna find it.
How do you see this?
Right there, right there.
Okay, look. Anybody else? We have like a few minutes. All right, that seems like everything. So thank you so much for listening. We talked for an hour. I'm really excited that we had such a good turnout for this workshop. It's like really intimidating trying to pick topics to talk about because you never know what people are gonna resonate with. So I hope you guys have a really awesome rest of DLC, and I'll see you around.